Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you that you are the Lord of all. Hallelujah. Lord, help us to make you Lord of all. Help us to allow you to be Lord of all in our lives, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Thank you, worship team. Hallelujah. A little bit fussy, huh? That's okay. Colin, thank you for filling in for me last week. And I know Patrick's not here, but maybe he's watching. Patrick, thank you for filling in last week as well. It's a blessing to know that if you're going to be away, that there's good people that can step into the pulpit and take over. And maybe one of these days, Jonah will get up here and fill that void. Huh? I just said that because he was looking at me. Praise the Lord. So Joshua, back to Joshua. Praise the Lord. I didn't get to watch last week, so I don't know what y'all did last week. And I'm going to go back and watch it as soon as I get a chance. Yeah. I didn't think you did. You told me you wasn't going to, so. 1 Corinthians. All right. I plan to go back and watch it. I'm assuming I can find it on Facebook, can't I, Angel? Yeah, that's a jab. Thanks. Joshua chapter 18. We're going to try to do, Lord willing, we're going to do 18, 19, and 20 tonight. There's allotments for seven of the tribes that we're going to look at tonight, and we'll probably jump through them very fast. But there's some good things in here that we're going to pull out and look at. Let me get my tablet on the right text here, just in case I want to jump over to it. Sometimes I like to jump back and forth from the NIV to the King James over to. I really like the Amplified Version. Anybody like the Amplified Version? Yeah, I love the Amplified Version, and I'll switch between those three sometimes, and sometimes in my notes I might have them one specific translation, but that way I've got this so I can switch back and forth. But Joshua chapter 18, let's look in verse 1 of chapter 18. It says this, it says, "The whole assembly of the Israelites gathered at Shiloh and set up the tent of meeting, there. The country was brought under their control, but there were still seven Israelite tribes who had not yet received their inheritance." Now, if you remember previously, the headquarters, you could say, for the Israelites when they crossed the Jordan was at Gilgal. If you remember when we first started in Joshua chapter 4, you can find this in chapter 4, verses 19 through 20 and verses 2 through 12 in chapter 4, that they camped at Gilgal. They camped at Gilgal. Now, there's no mention that at Gilgal that they set up the tabernacle. It doesn't mention it in the text, but we know that whenever they would stop, they would set up the tabernacle. And so they probably most likely set up the tabernacle there especially for the length of time that they were there. But the headquarters, the place of meeting, the tabernacle was moved from Gilgal now to Shiloh. And it was moved there for this reason, because it's a more central location. And it will remain there. That will be the place that the tabernacle will be set up until you'll find in 2 Samuel chapters 5 and 6 when David takes Jerusalem. After David takes Jerusalem, the city of David, then everything will begin to be moved there. And if you remember the story, after David took Jerusalem, then he brought the tabernacle, or brought the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem. You know, that's where you find the story of Uzzah, where when they was traveling with the Ark, and you know, only certain Levite priests are meant to carry the Ark. Only certain Levite priests can do certain things. And Uzzah was one of them that was not supposed to touch the ark. He wasn't supposed to help to carry the ark and all that. He was walking beside the ark. And when they stumbled, the ark began to fall, and he touched it, and it killed him. And so that's how he gets the nickname Uzzah Dummy. But because he knew better. And nobody laughed at my dad joke. But if you remember in 1 Samuel chapter 4, 5, and 6, I said a while ago that Shiloh was the place of meeting. It was the place where the tabernacle was constructed, where the tent of meeting was, and that was the main place. It went from Gilgal to Shiloh. And if you remember in 1 Samuel chapters 4, 5, and 6, the Philistines come in and they took the ark. That's some really good stories there in those chapters when they take the ark and they take it back and they put it in their temple to Dagon. And if you remember the stories, they would get up in the morning and Dagon would be laid face down before the ark of the Lord. The false god that they had built of Dagon would be laid there before the Lord face down. They would set it up, it'd be laid back down. Then they go in there one time and it's laid down and his head's come off, his hands have come off, and they begin to realize something was going on here. And then later on in the story, you begin to read, they begin to get tumors. They begin to get these cancerous type tumors on their body, and they was in such a bad place. They had so many things going wrong with them. They realized that, hey, we got to get rid of the Ark of God. We got to give it back to the people of Israel. So they send it back to the people of Israel with offerings, with a peace offering, because they was being tormented because of having the Ark of God that they stole from the Israelites. But there were still seven tribes. It says here in verse 2, it says, but there were still seven tribes in Israel that had not yet received their inheritance. Seven tribes. You could call them the seven lazy, procrastinating tribes. You could, really. I mean, it's there waiting for them, and they just kind of sitting back waiting for it to happen. You know, they were sitting back and waiting on the land to divide itself, pretty much. So Joshua calls them out in verse 3. It says, so Joshua said to the Israelites, how long will you wait before you begin to take possession of the land that the Lord, the God of your ancestors, has given you? Now, I'm going to tell you right now, you could write a sermon out of that text. Right there. You could stop right there in just verse 3 and write a whole sermon out of that, because that is good. Everybody say that is good. It is good. Joshua said to the Israelites, he said, how long will you wait before you begin to take possession of the land that the Lord, the God of your ancestors, has given you? How long will you wait to take a hold of what God has for you? You know, it's one thing to know the promises of God. It's one thing to know the Word of God, to read the Bible, to have it in you as far as in your memory. But it's another thing to live it out. They knew the promises of God. They knew that land was promised to them. But they weren't inhabiting that land. You know why? They hadn't stepped out by faith and taken the land. They hadn't stepped out by faith and had taken the land. It's one thing to know the promises of God. It's another thing to experience the promises of God. Amen? Tony Evans said this in one of his books. He said that God's promises may be within our reach, but not in our hands. God's promises may be within our reach, but not in our hands. Why? Because we haven't taken hold of it yet. We still have to do the work to take the land. The land won't divide itself. Amen? Israel went in, they began to conquer the land, and then Joshua split everybody up into tribes. He said, okay, now here's your allotment. Go take your land. Go finish the job. Go do what's left to be done. Jesus, he went to the cross. And he sent the Holy Spirit. Now, go be my disciples. Go tell the world. We're saved to serve. We're not saved to sit. Amen? It's the same concept. Joshua said, go, now conquer the land. Jesus said, now go. Go, be my disciples. Go. Tell people about me. Go. Reach the lost. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. We're saved to serve. We're not saved to sit. Remember what James said, that faith without works is dead? He said, faith without works is dead. Faith is not simply sitting back and waiting on everything to fall into our lap or waiting for everything to fall into place. It is actively living out our faith. Faith is actively living out what we believe. Amen? That's what faith is. Faith is actively living out what we believe. Jesus said in Matthew 6, he asked us, if the birds worried about tomorrow. Do the birds worry about tomorrow, or does God not take care of the birds and supply their needs? Now, I don't know how many in here are bird watchers. Okay. All right, y'all like to watch the birds, but how many birds do you see just sit on a limb with their mouth open waiting for a worm to fall in it? Only the chicks do that from the nest. They don't do that. What are they doing? They're hunting for something to eat, right? God provides it, but they got to go out and figure out what to do to get it, right? It was the same thing for the seven tribes that are sitting there waiting for their inheritance. They're doing nothing. They're standing there with their hands in their pockets. Those of you that's been out in the workforce, how many of you like to work with somebody that walks around like this all day? Easy now. I've earned the right to do that. And that sometimes too. But nobody likes that. You know why? Because you're doing all the work, right? That's kind of the way these Israelites were, these seven tribes. They're just sitting back there, kicking rocks. You know, it's like the kid out in the outfield that's just kind of picking, looking for a four-leaf clover, and they hit the ball over top of his head, and he don't even know it's there, you know? That would have been me playing baseball. But that's the way these Israelites were. You know, later on in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus talks about the birds and how God supplies, he provides for the birds. But he goes on in Matthew 6:33, this popular verse that most of you know. He says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you." Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Does that mean that we sit in a chair and look up to heaven and open our hands and say, "Oh Lord, help me. Lord, provide for me. I'm not going to get up, but just provide for me." That's not what that means. It means get up and live out your faith. Joshua told the Israelites, "Go, take the land. Take the land. We've done the first part, now it's your job." Jesus said in the Great Commission, "Go and preach the gospel to every creature." It's our job to go. It's our job to take the land. It's our job to go out and begin to take the land. "How long will you wait," Joshua said, "before you take possession of the land?" How long will we wait before we take possession of the things that God has for us in our lives? In verse 4 it says, Joshua said, appoint three men from each tribe. I will send them out and make a survey of the land. I will send them out to make a survey of the land and to write a description of it according to the inheritance of each. Then they will return to me, and you are to divide the land into seven parts. Judah is to remain in its territory on the south, and the tribes of Joseph in their territory on the north. After you have written descriptions of the seven parts of the land, bring them here to me, and I will cast lots for you in the presence of the Lord our God. The Levites, however, do not get a portion among you, because the priestly service of the Lord is their inheritance. And Gad, Reuben, and half the tribe of Manasseh have already received their inheritance on the east side of the Jordan. Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave it to them. As the men started on their way to map out the land, Joshua instructed them, "Go and make a survey of the land and write a description of it. Then return it to me, and I will cast lots for you here at Shiloh in the presence of the Lord." So the men left and went through the land. They wrote its description on a scroll, town by town and in seven parts, and returned to Joshua in the camp at Shiloh. And Joshua then cast lots for them in Shiloh in the presence of the Lord, and there he distributed the land to the Israelites according to their tribal divisions. You could say they were honoring their faith. You could say those seven tribes, like I said, like the birds, like the little chicks in the nest sitting there with their mouth open waiting for something to happen, were a little bit ornery in their faith. And we've all probably been ornery in our faith before and needed a push. And that's what Joshua does here, is he pushes them a little bit. He says, pick some men from each of your tribes, and we're going to send them out to survey the land. Let's go. Come on. Let's do something. Let's get up. Let's get your hands out of your pockets. Let's do a little something. Make some movement here. Make some progress here. Sometimes we need to be pushed spiritually, don't we? Sometimes we need a little push. I remember over the years being reluctant to preach before I become the pastor, being reluctant to preach from the pulpit. I remember times when Brother Mike would call upon me and ask me to preach, and I'm just so reluctant. Angel would speak up, and Brother Mike say he's going to be out of town. She'd speak up, Timmy would do it. And I'm like, whoa, wait a minute, woman. You know, I'm like Jesus at the wedding. Woman, it's not my time yet. You know, and I was very reluctant, but he would come to me and he would push me. And because he knew that I had a call upon my life to do this, but I was reluctant to answer that call. And Brother Mike would say, you know, why don't you preach for me? And it's always at the times that I just really didn't want to preach. You know what I'm saying? That I just really didn't feel it. There's just something going on in my life, and I felt like I didn't need to be up there in the pulpit. And that's always the times he would come to me and ask me, and it was the time I needed it the most, you know. Sometimes we need to be pushed spiritually. Sometimes we need that push. Amen? Hallelujah. It says here that Joshua cast lots to determine the land allotments. Now, some people would read this and they'd be like, aha, I can go to the boat this weekend. That's what they're going to look at it and think. They cast lots. That means I can go to the boat and it's okay. It's okay to gamble. This is not gambling. This is not spiritual gambling. You go back and you begin to study casting lots, and you find out that this was a thing. This was something that was used. It was actually ordered of the Lord in some circumstances, and it was used to determine God's will and take out the opinion of man, to take out human error, and allow and give God the ability to make the decision. Does that make sense? If you look in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 33, I'm going to read it to you. It says, the lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. The lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. In Leviticus chapter 16, God instructed Moses. This is in chapter 16, verses 6 through 10. He instructed Moses to have Aaron cast lots to determine which goat would be the goat for the sin offering and which goat would be the scapegoat. They cast lots. God instructed them to cast lots to do that. Some would say that, and it's possible, I don't know, that this casting of lots was the Urim and the Thummim that the priest had, the little stones on their breastplate that they would use to make the decisions. But this is the interesting thing. We could sit here and talk all day about gambling. We could talk about casting lots. We could talk about the Urim and the Thummim. And I'm probably not saying that correctly. But casting lots is even mentioned in the New Testament. When they chose the disciple to replace Judas that had committed suicide, they cast lots to determine which disciple they would choose. But that is the very last time you read of casting of lots. Now I want you to catch this. Because they cast lots to determine God's will. But after that point, when the Holy Spirit come upon the people, when the Holy Spirit come upon the believers, no more do you read about casting lots. You know why? We don't need to anymore. We have the Holy Spirit living within us. Now we can understand the will of God. Amen? Now we can understand the will of God. Now, in the rest of chapter 18 here, we begin to get into the allotments. In verse 11 through 20, we see the allotment for Benjamin. Actually, 11 through 28, you see the allotment for Benjamin. And then in chapter 19, verses 1 through 9, you see the allotment for Simeon. Chapter 19, 10 through 16, you see the allotment for Zebulun. And then verses 17 through 20. I think I was saying chapters, but verses 17 through 20 is Issachar. 24 through 31 is Asher. I'm not going to go through and read all of this. I mean, it's basically a deed. It's basically a deed. And then you'll see in verses 32 through 39 of chapter 19, Naphtali. Then we'll stop here for a moment. In verses 40 through 48, you see the allotment for Dan. That's the seven tribes that was left that hadn't received their allotment yet. And in the allotment for Dan, let's look in verse 40. It says, the seventh lot came out for the tribe of Dan, according to its clans. The territory of their inheritance included Zorah, Eshtaol, Shemesh, and let's skip on down. How about that? And in verse 47, because that's really where I want to go here in verse 47. It says, when the territory of the Danites was lost to them, they went up and attacked Leshem. They took it and put it to the sword and occupied it. They settled in Leshem and named it Dan after their ancestor. These towns and their villages were the inheritance of the tribe of Dan according to its clans. Now, the tribe of Dan chose to take an easier route than the route that was allotted for them. They didn't possess the land that was given to them by the casting of lots. They went to a land that was easier to occupy. Sometimes the path that God puts us on in our lives is not always easy. It's not always the path that we would choose. Sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes there's illness. Sometimes there's loss. Sometimes there's pain. Sometimes there's things that we go through for reasons that we don't understand. But I can tell you this, that I would much rather go in the path that God has for me, as hard as it may be, than my own path. You know, the Bible says that there's a way that seems right to a man, and the end thereof is destruction, death, destruction. We have a way that seems right to us, but it ends bad. The fact of the matter is, God's plan for our life may take us through some trials and tribulations and hard times, but if it's His plan, it's the right plan. Amen? If it's His will for our life, it's the right thing. It's the thing that we would be much better off in. Amen? The outcome is much better. In verse 49, it says, and when they had finished dividing the land into its allotted portions, this is in chapter 19, it says, when they had finished dividing the land into its allotted portions, the Israelites gave Joshua, the son of Nun, an inheritance among them. As the Lord had commanded, they gave him the towns he asked for, Timnath, Sirah, in the hill country of Ephraim. And he built up the town and settled there. These are the territories of Eleazar the priest, Joshua the son of Nun, and the heads of the tribal clans of Israel assigned by Lot at Shiloh in the presence of the Lord at the entrance to the tent of meeting. And so they finished dividing the land. Now, I want you to notice what took place here. Joshua and Caleb both, their allotments were not tribal. They were personal. They were personal. Joshua wasn't a tribe of himself. Caleb wasn't a tribe of himself. We read about him a few weeks ago. They both got their own allotments personally. Why? Because they were of the 12 spies that went into the land. And remember, they were the only two that returned with a good report, saying, yeah, we can go do it. Let's trust God. Let's take the land. And everybody else was like, whoa, wait a minute. They're too big. They're too tough. We can't do it. But Joshua and Caleb were like, yeah, we can do it. God said we can do it. And because of their faith, they're rewarded. Amen? They're rewarded because of their faith. (Clears throat) But the one thing that I want you to see here, or the other thing that I want you to see here in this portion of the text, in verses 49 through 51, is that Joshua sets the example of a good leader. Every tribe's had their allotment. Caleb had his allotment. Now it's Joshua's turn. Now you might think that Joshua, because he is the general of the army of Israel, he is the leader, he is Moses' successor, that you would think that he would get the prime real estate. Well, I've read more than one time studying on this text that the real estate that Joshua was allotted was not very good. It wasn't a very good land. It was rough. It was dry. It wasn't prime land. He didn't save the best for himself. And I thought about that, and I thought about, you know, what it means to be a leader, what it means to be an example setter. You know, Joshua sets the standard for humility and good leadership here. He waits till the last, and he doesn't take the best. He waits till the last, and he doesn't take the best. You know, I noticed years ago, serving on the board and serving under Pastor Mike, that when we would have a dinner, everybody was always adamant, and I was adamant myself, to make sure he's first in line. And that would get on his nerves. He didn't like that. And he would tell me, he'd say, "Tim, I don't want to be first in line." He says, "Matter of fact, I don't want a parking spot with my name on it. I want to park in the gravel." He said, "Because I think I need to set the standard for humility." He said, "And if I'm first in line, that makes it look like I'm elevated above everybody else in the congregation." He said, "I don't want that." And I thought, "But you're the pastor, you know." And I was all like, "Brother Mike, but you're the pastor. You need to be first and this and that." He said, "No, let the older people go first. Let the kids go first, not me." And I was always like, "I just don't understand that." And now that I'm the pastor, I'm like, don't ask me to be first, because I don't want to be. You know, because that mantle was passed on. And I realized once I stepped into that position that, well, he was right. I get it now. I understand it now. And that's the sign of, and that's what Joshua, we see in Joshua here, is he waits to last. You know, the first shall be last. The first shall be last. In chapter 20, we're going to look in the first three verses first here in chapter 20. We kind of change gears. We go from the land allotments, the division of the land, and now we're going to something a little bit different in chapter 20. It says, "Then the Lord said to Joshua, 'Tell the Israelites to designate the cities of refuge as I instructed you through Moses, so that anyone who kills a person accidentally and unintentionally may flee there and find protection from the avenger of blood.'" Now you might say, "Well, how in the world do you kill somebody accidentally?" Well, I mean, really, it can happen. We get a biblical example of, if you're swinging an axe and the axe head comes off and hits somebody and it kills them, then that's an accidental death. And it's used in the description of these cities of refuge. In Exodus chapter 21, verse 12 through 14, what's that? That's pretty good. Accidental. I never thought about it like that. Yeah, that's pretty good. We're not all as quick-witted as you are, kid. Exodus 21, verses 12 through 14. It says, "Anyone who strikes a person with a fatal blow is to be put to death. However," I always like "however." It usually means it gets a little bit better. "However, if it is not done intentionally, but God lets it happen, they are to flee to a place I will designate. But if anyone schemes and kills someone deliberately, that person is to be taken from my altar and put to death." Numbers chapter 35, verses 9 through 15. "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Speak to the Israelites and say to them, when you cross the Jordan into Canaan, select some towns to be your cities of refuge, to which a person who has killed someone accidentally may flee. They will be places of refuge from the avenger, so that," and that's not the Avengers, by the way, Peyton, "from the avenger, so that anyone accused of of murder. I kept seeing Captain America and all of these figures as I was studying this today, you know, the Avengers. So that anyone accused of murder may not die before they stand trial before the assembly. These six towns you give will be your cities of refuge. Give three on this side of the Jordan and three in Canaan as the cities of refuge. These six towns will be a place of refuge for Israelites and foreigners residing among them so that anyone who has killed another accidentally can flee there. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 41 and 43, it says this. It says, then Moses set aside three cities east of the Jordan. The three cities were Bezer in the wilderness plateau for the Reubenites, Ramoth in Gilead for the Gadites, and Golan in Bashan for the Manassites. So we see here some scripture references to let us know what's being spoken of here, what these cities of refuge were. It wasn't just something that just come up. It wasn't something that just was on Joshua's mind. It was something that was laid out. God laid out before Moses. You see there in Exodus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy that God laid this out. It was his intention for this to take place. Now, the avenger of blood was someone appointed by a family, appointed by a tribe, appointed by a clan to avenge the blood of someone that obviously had been murdered or someone that had been killed. It didn't necessarily have to be someone that was murdered as in premeditated. It was even the accidental death. And this is something that still is a reality in many cultures. It's still a reality in many cultures. And you find that if something happens to a loved one, we find ourselves kind of having that same thought process sometimes. You know, I'll be honest with you. If somebody shoots my dog, I'm pretty upset. I don't know if I'm going to appoint an avenger of blood, but I kind of want to. You know what I'm saying? Huh? Yeah. And so, right. Well, I mean, the avenger of blood, are you saying that's what I'm talking about, accidental? Right. Right. Right, exactly. Exactly. Kind of like the Hatfields and McCoys. There's always avenging each other. Yeah. But, you know, the thing of it is that although God is just, and this is what you need to see out of this, is that although God is just, and even in the Old Testament, many people will see God as vengeful. They'll see God as ruthless. They'll see God as merciless. Merciless, however you say that. But in reality, when we look at this, we see God merciful. When you think about the context of what we're reading, we see God in His mercy. He ordered these cities be scattered throughout the land, three on one side of the Jordan, three on the other side of the Jordan, but strategically placed so that it took took around a day's walk to get to these. It was a day's journey to get to any of these cities. So they were strategically placed. And then they weren't just random cities. When you study a little bit deeper, you find out that these were Levitical cities. These were cities where he placed his priest. Remember we talked about that there were cities set aside. The Levites didn't get an inheritance, but they did receive cities within each of the tribal allotments. There was 48 cities allotted for the Levites mixed within all the allotments of all the tribes of Israel. And six of those cities, strategically placed, were the cities of refuge. Six out of the 48 cities were the cities of refuge. Verse 4, chapter 20. It says, when they flee to one of these cities, they are to stand in the entrance of the city gate and state their case before the elders of that city. Then the elders are to admit the fugitive into their city and provide a place to live among them. If the avenger of blood comes in pursuit, the elder must not surrender the fugitive because the fugitive killed their neighbor unintentionally and without malice aforethought. Verse 6, they are to stay in that city until they have stood trial before the assembly and until the death of the high priest who is serving at that time. Then they may go back to their own home, in the home of from which they fled. So they kept apart Kadesh in Galilee, in the hill country of Naphtali, Shechem in the hill country of Ephraim, and Kiriath Arba, that is Hebron, in the hill country of Judah, east of the Jordan, on the other side of the Jericho. They designated Bashir in the wilderness, on the plateau of the tribe of Reuben, Ramoth in Gilead, the tribe of Gad, and Golan in Bashan in the tribe of Manasseh. Verse 9, any of the Israelites or any foreigner residing among them who killed someone accidentally could flee to these designated cities and not be killed by the avenger of blood prior to standing trial before the assembly. Now, in several ways, these cities point us to Christ. In a few ways, I want to show you this evening that these cities of refuge point us to Jesus. One is this, is that it was the duty of the Jews to point the way to these cities. It was the duty of the Jews to point their way to the cities. In Deuteronomy chapter 3, in the Amplified Version, it says this. And I thought this was interesting because I read it in the NIV and I was like, that don't make sense. I read it in the Amplified and I thought, okay, that makes more sense. So I go back to the King James and it was almost like the Amplified translated the King James better than the NIV did. So I put the Amplified on here to read this evening. In Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 3, in the Amplified Version, it says, you shall prepare and maintain for yourself the roads to these cities, and divide the territory of your land into three parts, so that anyone who kills another unintentionally may escape there for asylum. Now, I've read from other places, other non-biblical sources, that the roads would be regularly maintained. And it makes sense when you read it in verse 3 in the Amplified Version, that these roads would be regularly maintained and that there would be signs placed along the way pointing to the city saying refuge. In plain sight, easy to be seen. That there would be signs placed there. Now, how does that point us to Jesus? I mean, think about it. What is our job? Our job is to be like those signs. Jesus is our refuge, and it's our job, our responsibility, to stand in the way and point people to Christ. Amen? To point people to Jesus, who is our rock. He is our strong tower. He is our refuge. He is the one to which we turn. The second way is this. The doors of the cities were always open. The doors to these cities were always open. You know, in those times, generally the doors would be closed. They guarded them well. But the doors to these cities were open so that the fugitives could make it into the city, make it into the city of refuge. In John chapter 6, verse 37, Jesus said, whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. In Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, it says, the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life. Jesus is an open door. Amen. Jesus is an open door. He said, I stand at the door and knock, and if you will open the door, I will come and I will eat with you. He is an open door. The third way is this, is the cities were not exclusively for the Jews. The cities were not exclusively for the Jews. In Numbers 35:15, it says, these six cities shall be a refuge for the Israelites, for the stranger and the resident alien among them, so that anyone who kills a person unintentionally may escape there. In Joshua chapter 20, verse 9, it says, any of the Israelites or any foreigner residing among them who killed someone accidentally could flee to these designated cities. It's not exclusively for the Jews. Paul said in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, he says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel." He says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God. It is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew and then to the Gentile." It's not exclusively for the Jews. It's for the strangers among them as well. You and I are the strangers among them. Amen? And the fourth is this, a fugitive that did not flee to one of these cities had no hope. A fugitive that did not flee to one of these cities of refuge had no hope. There was no protection from the avenger of blood if you didn't flee to one of these cities. No protection whatsoever. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He's the only way to the Father. It's exclusive. Christianity is exclusive in that there is no other way. But it's also inclusive in that God so loved the world that He sent His Son to die so that whoever believes in Him can have eternal life. It's exclusive in that Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only way. You either believe Him and put your faith in Him, or you end up finding yourself in a devil's hell. There's only one way to Jesus. There's only one way to the Father, and that's through Him. But it's inclusive in that he would that none would perish, but all that would come to eternal life. He loved the world so much that He sent His Son so that whosoever, anybody, everybody, could have eternal life if they believe in Him. The only aspect in which these cities don't parallel with our relationship with Jesus is these cities were set aside for the innocent. They were set aside for those that accidentally took a life. They didn't deserve to be put to death because it was an accident. They didn't mean to do it. They didn't premeditatedly do it. There's where the difference lies. Jesus died because we're guilty. He is our refuge because we are guilty, not because we're innocent and we have to run from the avenger of blood. We're guilty. The Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Amen? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We all need Jesus. We all need Jesus to be our refuge. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm done a little bit early. Anybody got any prayer requests? I got several wrote down here that I thought of when I was looking at my notes a while ago. Yes, sir. What's his name? Tim. I like him. You said he pastored the deaf church?
Yes, for many years. We did a lot of things together over the years.
They were tired about it here. Mm-hmm.
Lynn?
Lynn Darty.
All right. Yeah. Huh? Okay. Gotcha. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Yeah. I think she had COVID or had some complications or something. Yeah. From what I read earlier. Yes, ma'am.
My uncle had went into the ICU last week.
Oh, really?
All their services and stuff are in Texas.
Texas?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Huh? Yeah, I got her down here. All right. Let's pray. Father, we just come to you tonight, Lord God, and we thank you for hearing our prayers. We thank you for answering our prayers, Lord God. We thank you that your ears are not deaf to us, Lord God, that you hear us. And Lord God, that you not only hear, but you answer, Lord God, in Jesus' name. We thank you for taking notice, God, of our needs and of the needs of these that we pray for, God, in Jesus' name. And Father, we just lift these needs up, Lord God. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray for Gloria and her family, Lord God, as they lost her sister today, Lord God. We pray for your hand to be upon the family, God, in Jesus' name. I pray that her sister knew you, Lord God, in Jesus' name. And Father, Lord, just touch them. Help it to cause the family to look unto you. In the name of Jesus, and Father, we give you glory. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray for Rob Long, Lord God, and we just pray for a complete healing to him, that you give him favor in the situation that he's dealing with, Lord. And I pray for his dad. Lord, we pray together, believing for healing to his dad, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for Timmy Ray and the situation tomorrow. I pray that you give him favor, him and Isaiah both. Give him favor. Help him make good decisions. Help him put you first. Help him to trust you. And God, I pray that you heal him as well. And that next week goes well, that there's get a good report from the doctor. And that you just work a miracle, Lord God. I pray that that thing that he's getting looked at just disappears. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray for Glenn Wombles. Lord, we pray for a continued healing. Lord God, we thank you for the praise report we heard Sunday, and we pray that we hear more in Jesus' name. And Father, I pray that you not just heal him, but I pray that you just move upon his family. I pray that we begin to see his family come to church with him, God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray for Pastor Tim, the cancer, Lord God, that he's been diagnosed with. Lord, I pray that you just take it from him. I pray that you heal him right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God, as he's served you, Lord God. He's been a servant, Lord God, to the people and to you. And God, we pray in your precious name that you just do a great work in his life, that you heal him, Lord, from the top of his head, Lord, to the soles of his feet, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for Lynn. Lord, we pray for healing in his toe. Lord, we rebuke blood clots, and we pray in the name of Jesus for healing. And we trust you, Lord, in it. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Lord, we pray for a lady at work. She mentioned her brother, Glenn, that he's been dealing with a lot of things. And she said he knows the Lord, but he's just not living where he needs to be, and that he's in bad health. And Lord, we pray for healing. Pray for healing physically and healing spiritually, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we lift up Jason and Tricia and Lois, Lord God, as they've been sick, Lord God. Lord, we pray for healing to them. We pray that you touch them, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, that you heal them of this illness, whatever it is, Lord God. I know they're coming out of it, Lord, but I pray that you just make that recovery quick, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we pray for Jade's uncle's family, Lord God, for that family in Texas. Lord, we pray that you touch them. Lord, we pray for just favor there, Lord. I pray that if they don't know you, they come to know you. I pray that you put people in their path, Lord God, to share you with them, Lord God, in Jesus' name, to speak the goodness of God into their lives. And Father, we thank you and we give you praise. Hallelujah, Lord, we just give you glory. And I pray that you heal me of whatever this is that's been bugging me the last 2 days, Lord. I pray that you heal me, help me to not lose my voice. Help me to not have a sore throat. And God, I pray that you just touch me right now from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, God. And I rebuke you, devil. I command you to flee in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we just take authority over this thing and we call it done in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for being with us tonight, Lord God. And I pray that you help us, Lord God, to live out our faith before you. To live out our faith before you and before people. God, in Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you and we give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen.